Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Trust you had a good Sabbath.
Yes.
If you were here or you were worshipping elsewhere on the island, it's been a lovely day.
Yes.
It's good to get to meet together again before the week's kind of finished. I guess we'll meet as we begin the next week. But it really has been a pleasure to have been here with you this last week. Here on this beautiful island, you have truly made my wife and I feel at home and welcomed and as part of your family. So it's been a good time. And it's always a pleasure to share God's word with God's people. Because I believe there's something powerful that takes place when God's church gathers to study his word. Hearts are changed, lives are changed, and God willing, I believe it will be reflected in eternity.
Amen.
Today, as we start, if you turn to Revelation, and we'll bow our heads for prayer. Revelation 16. Revelation 16, let's bow our heads to pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we pause to thank you for this lovely Sabbath day. We thank you, Lord, for this day when we've been able to come aside and rest from all the cares and worries of this world. And as we now spend a few moments, Lord, meditating once again on your word, we pray that you would speak through your word. That it would touch our hearts, that it would teach us, that it would guide us, that it would instruct us, that it would convict us if need be, and that we may be drawn closer to you. I pray that you would speak through me. I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Our sermon title this evening is entitled Deliverance. Deliverance. When you look through the pages of the Old Testament in particular, you find the account of a God who likes the dramatic deliverance, do we not? You have the children of Israel in Egypt, and there they are, we're not quite sure the exact number, but it was in the millions, and they leave Egypt and start walking across the desert. They haven't gone too far when Pharaoh scratches his head and is like, we just lost a lot of free labor. Time to get them back. So he sends out his armies to get the Israelites back. And as he sends out his armies to get the Israelites back, they could have been anywhere, but it just so happened that they're facing a big sea in front of them. God's like, okay, let them come, let them come, let them come. And they get real close, and then all of a sudden, like, you can't invent this. You and I could not imagine this happening. God's like, okay, pulls the Red Sea apart, and God's children walk over on the Red Sea. They all get onto dry land, turn around, and the sea comes back together again. They're marching, and finally, after their 40 years, they make it to the Promised Land. They go there, and they're there just over the Jordan. And what's there? The biggest city that could be is right in front of them. God's like, no problem. Just take a wander around it. And as they take a little wander around the city, singing songs and bang, the city collapses. You know, historically speaking, there's something interesting because archaeologists can't find the city of Jericho. So it's a problem. Or it's not. It's a confirmation.
Yeah.
So either the city of Jericho, and I'm kind of off topic here, it either means that the whole city and story didn't happen, or it means this, and this is what our tour guide told us in Israel, it either means this, that when God destroys, he destroys completely.
Yeah.
And we can't find that thing anymore. It's gone. There's obviously a new city. The city of Sodom and Gomorrah, God waits for Lot and his wife to leave and then rains fire and brimstone down. The whole Old Testament is full of these amazing stories of how God rescues his people. And the Bible ends, as we looked at this morning, and we'll finish this evening, with one of the most dramatic rescue stories ever. I mean, Hollywood tries to write these dramatic rescue stories where someone saves someone else. And sometimes they kind of make it look better than it was. You know, it's interesting. You know the story of Desmond Doss that's in the movies now? Hacksaw Ridge? I was reading a review of it where they were comparing Hollywood to real life. You know what they said they had to do? It's a fascinating story if you get a chance to read the book. They said that Hollywood had to take out some of the things he did.
Because the story would be too long.
Otherwise, they said it would be too unbelievable.
Wow.
So they did the opposite this time. Because you know he saved 75 men, and then finally when he got shot, he was on a stretcher as he was going to the aid station, and he saw a man on his right-hand side, and he said, let me go and help him, while he's shot and arm blown off. No, he wasn't shot yet, he was shot somewhere else. So he rolls off the tray, goes over to help this man, bandages him up. While he's bandaging him up, he got shot in the arm and blew his left arm off. And he's left there for 5 hours on the battlefield and crawled 300 yards to safety on his own. Hollywood said, yeah, people won't believe that. Take the bit out. But God, though, is writing a story that's, in a sense, even more unbelievable. Like, things can happen that Hollywood can't imagine. So, as we go on our presentation this evening, we're just going to step back into the presentation this morning just to review one or two things before we step forward. Now, Revelation 13, verse 15 is that text that's dealing with the mark of the beast and with the death decree when it says, and he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and, what's the next word? And cause, and that word there is key. He would cause, meaning there would be coercion or force involved. He would cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. This here is indicating a time future when worship will be required on pain of death. Worship will be required on pain of death. Will you stay true to your convictions? Or will you love your life more than your convictions? And God's people will have that very real, very tangible challenge before them. Now, we saw this morning how the plagues begin to fall. We saw that in Revelation chapter 16, the plagues begin to fall. The first plague, the second plague. And while the plagues are falling, the anger of the wicked people is aroused. And they start to think, these plagues are because of those righteous people. Now, I don't know what the numbers of the righteous people are going to be. No one knows. We don't know what the numbers are. Okay? But think about this. If you were to look back into recent human history, when I say recent, I'm talking the last century. If you're looking back into recent human history, and you look at how many people, for example, the German army killed in World War II, or you look into fact in recent history, how many were killed by the Americans? Or how many were killed by the Russians? And you look at World War II, for example, or you look at the Vietnam War, you look at World War I. I don't know why they call it the Great War. But you look at these wars, and you'll see that hundreds of thousands, millions of people were killed in wartime. So you can imagine, at this time, if you've got a small group of righteous people on the earth defying and living differently to everyone, follow the line, that the wicked are like, we have capability in our army, military capacity to wipe out whole nations. You understand? I mean, you take the United States military power, they're huge. And they must think, well, if we can wipe out a whole nation, then surely we can destroy this small group of people over here. And this is why God's like, okay. It's almost like man has invented so much machinery. I mean, you know today, I mean, if you actually want to hide, you can't. Amen. 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 I mean, it's some people that want to run far away into the mountains. You can't hide. I mean, they can fly over with a helicopter that's got the infrared and the sensor of body heat and all those. Like, you can't hide. You can only hide if God's angels are protecting you. And all of a sudden, the infrared doesn't work. And all of a sudden, the body sensor doesn't work. Can't find anyone there. And so they want to kill the righteous because they think it's just a small group. We have capability in our armaments to just destroy them easily. And so they say we're going to kill them. So a death decree is passed sometime after the probation while the plagues are still falling. But it's not enforced straight away. And as we've already seen this morning, we can see from the book of Esther that there's a precedent for a death decree and some time before it is enforced. And in the book of Esther, God interceded for his people. Notice here, as the time appointed in the death decree draws near, the people will conspire to root out the hated sect. It will be determined to strike in how quick? One night. So because it's a small number, and because our weapons are so big, and because we are so many, it will only take us one night to do it. We can get it over and done with. Job done. To silence the voice of dissent and reproof. You see, this begins the time of Jacob's trouble. This is Jacob's time of trouble, where the righteous will wrestle with God. And their experience will be one where they say, I will not let you go except you bless me. They're praying for deliverance, but they're praying that they have the faith to make it through. Because there's one thing that the righteous have learned by this point, and the one thing the righteous have learned by this point is that they cannot trust themselves. Because the reality is, and you and I in our Laodicean condition are probably sitting here thinking, well, when that happens, I'll just know that I'm okay. Because I haven't got a plague yet. Like, isn't that a rational argument? Like, if I haven't got the plagues, I don't have a plague. Do you have a boil? I don't have a boil. Do you have a boil? No, we don't have boils. So if I don't have a boil, and if I'm still able to drink nice water because the Lord's provided nice water for me, then, hey, we're good. Like, let's just gather around in the mountains and have a little prayer meeting and sing songs and praise the Lord and count down till he comes. Like, that's what we think in our rational mind today.
Yeah.
Or you could say our rational Laodicean proudful mind. Because when you read the experience of them, they're not there counting their chickens before they hatch, so to speak. They are still pleading with God, even up until the very end. That they'll still have the faith to make it through. Notice here it says, though God's people will be surrounded by enemies who are bent upon their destruction, yet the anguish which they suffer is not a dread of persecution. They're not actually scared of the persecution. They fear that every sin has not been repented of, and that through some fault in themselves, they will fail to realize the fulfillment of the Savior's promise. So even at this point, they're still examining Lord. They're still examining their lives. They're still pleading for a closer walk with God. They're still pleading for God to purify their hearts. I will keep you from the hour of temptation which shall come upon the Lord, Revelation 3:10. If they could have an assurance of pardon, they would not shrink from torture or death. But should they prove unworthy and lose their lives because of their own defects of character, then God's holy name would be what? Reproached. So part of what they're pleading for is that they don't want to offend the name of God. I'm a Christian. I profess to be a Christian. That means a follower of Christ. Therefore, my life should reflect Christ.
Amen.
How lightly we take the word Christian today.
Mm-hmm.
How lightly we take it. As if it's a birthright, something we're born with, not something we live. I was born a Christian. Oh, really? When? I was born in a Christian home. That's how we talk. But it somehow infuses the way we think. Well, because we have been born in a Christian home, that we have just grown up being a Christian. You see, the wicked, though, they get a little bit impatient. And they can't wait until midnight. Sorry, they can't wait until daylight to execute the decree. It's not like they're sleeping in their beds. All right, mate, yeah. 8 o'clock. Okay, we'll get to it then. Uh-uh. They say, we'll just wait until midnight. Till midnight. Some of you have stayed up till midnight to get sales. Someone say amen. You waited up till midnight on Thursday to get a Black Friday sale online. So you can see, if you can wait up till midnight just to get 20% off, how much more with the wicked who want to get rid of the problem that's plaguing the world, be like, you know what, we can stay up till midnight. That's not a problem. And we'll do it at midnight instead of doing it at 5 or 6 in the morning. You know, I've been reading these stories of the Waldenses, and one of the stories of the Waldenses, terribly sad, was April 24th, 1655. In January of that year, they had driven the Waldenses up to the mountains and said, either you come to Mass or you leave where you stay. So they had to go from the lower valleys up to the higher valleys. January. But April the 24th, the Duke of Savoy said, I just want to wipe these people out. On April the 24th, 1655, at 4 a.m., they started the slaughter. And it was gruesome. It was gruesome. They plowed men into the fields. And it's just terrible. And some people escaped up to a mountain called Castelluzzo, and then they got pushed off there. But the point I'm trying to make is, they did it at 4 a.m. Meaning they had enough restraint to be like, oh, well, let's just wait till early morning. Here, though, there's no restraint of a 4 a.m. They're like, we'll just stay up late tonight and get this one done. And they say, we're going to do it at midnight? Now think, as we go through some of the upcoming slides, from 11 to 12 is the last hour that the saints of God will ever agonize over anything. Because something happens at midnight of that day. And it's quite surreal to think, on that day, that'll be the last 1 hour, that'll be the last half an hour, that'll be the last 15, 10, 5 minutes that they ever agonize over anything. They may know that the death decree is coming, and they're agonizing, they're pleading with God. And that last hour up until midnight is the last time they'll ever agonize over anything. Notice here, could men see with heavenly vision, they would behold companies of angels that excel in strength, stationed about those who have kept the words of Christ's patience. They would see the angels stationed around each person. Wow. Just standing there. And then it goes on to say, with sympathizing tenderness, angels have witnessed their distress and heard their prayers. They are waiting the word of their commander to snatch them from peril. So the angels are there saying, let's rescue them. And God's like, not yet. He says, not yet. Reading on, it says, they must wait a little longer. The people of God must drink of the cup and be baptized with the baptism. And then it says, the very delay, so painful to them, is the best answer to their petitions. Why? Why? As they endeavor to wait trustingly for the Lord to work, they are led to exercise what? Faith, hope, and patience, which have been too little exercised during their experience. Church, we are an impatient church. We are impatient. There's no other way around it. We lack that trait of character that God wants us to develop, where he can eventually say at the end, here is the patience of the saints. So God's like, no, they got to wait a little bit longer. When you look at the past 20, 30 years of their life, they had very little patience. They can wait a little bit longer. And what seems painful to the people of God to wait just a little bit longer is needed by them. As much as possible, we should seek to develop patience in our experience today. Yes. And not be so hasty. But as for the patience of Christ, you see, as the hour draws near, the angels of God are there. And can you picture in your minds when you've got a group of believers over here, and you've got a group of believers over there, and you've got a group of believers over there in another part of the world, and around them, we're told, is a group of angels around them. But then around the group of angels, which may be seen or may be unseen, is the wicked people who have encircled them, ready to go. And then behind the wicked people are the evil angels, in a sense, driving them on. So you've got four circles. The righteous, the good angels, the wicked angels. And though we know from Revelation, Satan has a lot of angels. He's got 1/3 of the angels. But when he tries to drive his people on, God's angels stand around his people and they protect. God's angels stand around his people and they protect him. Then deeper, and then what happens? Deeper than the shadow of the darkness of night, light falls upon the earth. Then a rainbow, shining with the glory from the throne of God, spans the heavens and seems to encircle each praying company. Like, it's hard to even explain it, to visualize it. There's going to be a rainbow that's kind of going to come from heaven, but it starts to encircle each praying group around the world. Amazing. Beautiful. That in the midst of the darkness of the night, there's going to be these rainbows encircling God's righteous people. Imagine being one of those righteous people, waiting for the blow to fall, when all of a sudden you look up and see a rainbow over your heads. And they look up and see this rainbow, and the angry multitudes are suddenly arrested. They stop. They stop. Their mocking cries die away. The objects of their murderous rage are forgotten. And with fearful forebodings, they gaze upon the symbol of God's covenant and long to be shielded by his brightness. They're about to go, and all of a sudden a rainbow, and they're like, oh, gotta run from here. It's too bright. And they forget all the hatred that they've built up against these people, and they just want to preserve their own life and get out of there. But imagine to be one of God's people then. I mean, who knows how close they get? I mean, we read a quote this morning where it says, like, the swords are raised and fall like a straw. Maybe God allows the people to get really close. Maybe they're right in their face when all of a sudden the rainbow comes. They just fall back. And crawling away, they try to get out of there. And God's children, behold his brightness. She says, everything in nature seems turned out of course. The streams cease to flow. Dark, heavy clouds come up and clash against each other. And in the midst of the angry heavens is one clear space of indescribable glory, whence comes the voice of God. There's this space, and the voice of God comes down, echoing from far off to his people. And no matter what side of the globe you're on, the east, the south, the north, the west, The writers hear the voice of God as it comes echoing down to his people. Where is this clear space? That's from Great Controversy. Early writing tells us where this clear space is. It says dark, heavy clouds. Similar quotation, but she adds a bit more detail. Dark, heavy clouds came up and clashed against each other. The atmosphere parted and rolled back. Then we could look up through the open space in where?
Orion.
Whence came the voice of God. And she says that's where the holy city will come from. So they look up, or they hear through Orion, the voice of God coming down to speak to his people. Revelation 16, verse 17 to 21. This dates the events thus described. The seventh plague comes before the coming of Christ and starts at the midnight hour set to execute God's people. Revelation 16, verse 17. And the seventh angel poured his vial into the air, and there was a great voice out of the temple in heaven from the throne saying, it is done. That's the time when the wicked are supposed to kill the righteous. But that's when the rainbows come, the clouds clash, and coming down through Orion, the voice of God echoing from heaven saying, it is done. Like, you can't imagine what that would sound like. The most high-tech sound system in the world can't duplicate what God's voice will sound like, echoing down through the ages. Ellen White says, the mountain shaped like a reed, if you know, you read through. The mountain shaped like a reed, and the ragged rocks are scattered on every side. There is a roar of a coming tempest. The sea is lashed into a fury. There is heard the shriek of a hurricane, like the voice of demons on a mission of destruction. The shriek of a hurricane. I've never heard a hurricane. I know you get them here fairly often. The whole earth heaves and swells like the waves of the sea. The earth is heaving and it's swelling. She says the mountain, the surface is breaking up. The very foundations seem to be giving way. Mountain chains are sinking. Inhabited islands disappear. Help us, Lord. And in Bermuda, they said amen. I live in England. It's an island too. My mom's from Iceland, that's an island. My dad's from Mauritius, that's an island. Help us, Lord. Like, we'll let God deal with that problem. Someone say amen. Like, God can handle that one. He can keep his people alive and let the island disappear all at the same time. Like, God is God, and we don't need to question how he will do that. But he will keep his people safe, and we don't have to kind of like, you know, leave an island to get to land because we don't want to be, you know what I'm saying. Let God deal with that one. Let's read Psalms. Maybe you know that text by memory. Maybe you learned it in Sabbath school. I don't know. But Psalms 46, I believe, will be particularly applicable at this time.
Yep.
Psalms 46 will be particularly applicable at this time where God's people can say these promises and claim them in real life experience. Psalm 46, verse 1, the Bible says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, though the mountains are carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. Selah. It says there, God is our refuge and strength in time of trouble. And at this time, when the seventh plague comes, and mountains are moving, islands are disappearing, earthquakes coming, such as never has there been an earthquake like it. Like the Lisbon earthquake of 1755, never one like the one to come. Never one like the one become. She says the seaports that have become like Sodom and Gomorrah for wickedness are swallowed by the angry waves. You know, most of the old cities of the world are seaports. And you can just go through some of the big seaport cities of the world that are known that are not known for righteousness. Your New Orleans, your San Franciscos, your New Yorks, your Miamis, your Londons, and the list goes on and on. Seaports, swallowed by the waves. You know, there's going to be a resurrection at this time. Like, God's not done with the drama yet. Like, just before he comes, he's still got time just to do something extra. To do something extra special for his people. You see, Revelation 20 verse 6 says, blessed and holy is he that has part in the what? First resurrection. But there was a text we read, we didn't read it this morning. Turn it to Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12, and the Bible says, Daniel chapter 12 and verse 2. We didn't read it this morning. We'll read it now. Daniel 12 and verse 2. And the Bible says there. Now in verse 1, let's just read verse 1 again. Verse 1 says, and at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which stands for the children of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation even to that same time. Then it says, and at that time your people shall be what? Living. Everyone that's found written in the book. And then it says, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. This verse is interesting because it's one of the few, if only, verses where you have the resurrection of the righteous and wicked in the same verse. Now, normally, as good Adventists, we understand that the resurrection of the righteous is at the beginning of the 1,000 years, and the resurrection of the wicked is at the end of the 1,000 years. They are two separate events. But here in this verse, it puts the resurrection of a good one and a bad one right together. I believe Daniel 12 verse 2 is talking of a special resurrection that will take place prior to his return. Now, Ellen White also comments on this. And we also find this elsewhere in the Bible in Revelation 1 verse 7 and Matthew 27. Mm-hmm. A special resurrection, one for the righteous and one for the wicked. Notice here. GC 6:37. All who have died in the faith of the third angel's message come forth from the tomb glorified to hear God's covenant of peace with those who have kept his what?
Law.
Those who have kept his law. So let's unpack that a little bit. All who have died in the faith of the what? Meaning, those who have died since 1844. Why? Because since 1844 was when we began to sound the third angel's message. So those faithful saints of old, they will be resurrected just prior to Jesus' return so that they can, alive, see the final events that they believed and preached about. Like David will have to wait in the grave until the Lord's basically here. He's not in heaven yet, amen. Making sure they get the wrong prophet. Abraham, Paul, they will have to wait until God calls them from the grave when everyone else comes. But just before his return, here, there'll be a special resurrection. All who have been died in the faith of the third angel's message will come forward. I don't know how much longer it is before the second coming. Is it a day? Is it a week? Is it a few hours? Either way, it's a special privilege in recognition of their faithfulness in the end times. It could be a week. It could be 3 hours. It could be 4 days. But just prior to Jesus' return, be a special resurrection. And you know some of those folks who died with their faith strong in the message. I remember there was this one man in our church when I was growing up. And I remember him when I was about 10 years old talking to my mother. And he was saying, I believe I'm going to see Jesus come. And you know those people too that have had that faith. I believe I'll see Jesus come. And then you also know that we've been to the church for the funeral, put the coffin in the ground and filled the grave in. And God's like, I remember those people. And they lived for me at a time of Earth's history that was tough. And I'm going to bring those people from the grave just before I come back. So that if you and I perish before Jesus comes, we know that we have the privilege to rise and still see the cloud the size of a man's hand coming. Like, we don't have to miss out on that. Someone say amen. We don't have to miss out on that. But there's a resurrection for the wicked as well. Those who pierce Jesus. Revelation 1:7, we looked at this the other day. Behold, he comes with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which... Now, we don't know exactly of those who pierced him who will rise. We know Caiaphas will come up, because Jesus looked at him and said, you're going to see me coming. So we know for sure Caiaphas. We don't know exactly who else. You know the Roman centurion? I believe he's going to be resurrected. But it's not going to be this one. Because the Roman centurions testified of Jesus. Surely this man is the Son of God. But the others, maybe. Maybe some of the other priests. Maybe some of the men that punched and spit on Jesus. Maybe some of them. Maybe the ones who mocked and made fun of him the most. I don't know. But some of them, we're not sure who, are going to come up from the grave. And can you imagine what it'll be like for them to look and see Jesus come? Like the last time they saw him, he was hanging on a cross, naked, bloody, crown of thorns on his head, everyone's mocking. And now he's coming with thousands and thousands of angels. It'll be a terrible time for them. This will be a time when the saints sing. Psalms 46. God is our refuge and strength. And this will be a time when appears in the sky the hand of God holding two tables of stone. You know, the skeptics amongst us, because we always have skeptics, amen? Yes, amen. No, sir, but what language is it going to be written in? And you know what I say? I don't care. I just know I'll be able to read it. I'll be able to read it. Most likely it'll be in English, because we can't learn anything else. And the voice of God will declare the day and hour of his coming. So a short time before his return, his voice will actually declare to his people the day and the hour of his return. How long that will be? A day before? 3 days before? A week before? I don't know. But a short while before, after there's this resurrection of the righteous, he then declares the day and hour of his coming. We don't know how much longer before his second coming it's going to be, though. She goes on and says, the Israel of God stand listening with their eyes fixed upward. Their countenances are lighted up with his glory and shine as if the face of Moses when he came down from Sinai. The wicked cannot look upon them. And when the blessing is pronounced on those who have honored God by keeping his Sabbath holy, there is a mighty shout of victory. God says, I'm going to bless these people, and I'm coming to take you home. And there's a shout of victory. But you know, it's still not over yet. It's still not over yet. Soon, there appears in the east a small black cloud about the size of a man's hand. It is the cloud which surrounds the Savior and which seems in the distance to be shrouded in darkness. The people of God, they know what it is. They say this is the sign of the Son of Man. They know exactly what this is. And the people of God know this to be the sign. It says, in solemn silence they gaze upon it as it draws brighter and brighter, becoming brighter and more glorious until it is a great white cloud. You know, at this point, God's children, even at this point, after they've been delivered, Even at this point, after a rainbow has encircled their head and the wicked have fled, even at this point, the righteous still say, who is able to stand? Doesn't that seem kind of like at this point, after they've been through so much, and as Jesus is coming, they're like, huh? You see, it's appropriate that humanity should feel its weakness in the presence of a coming king. It's appropriate that humanity would feel weak as the Savior comes in his glory, with all the angels in their glory. You know how many angels are going to come? The Bible says 10,000 times 10,000 and 1,000,000. You know, if you add that number up, you know what you come to? And it's not really a real number, but let's just say it is a real number. If you do add that number up, you know what you come to? 5 trillion angels, give or take a few. Let's just suppose there was 5 trillion angels. I think there's probably more. But let's suppose it was 5 trillion angels. You know how much land space you would need to accommodate 5 trillion angels? And let's suppose each angel needed 2 square meters with their wings folded. You would need an area 3 times the surface of this earth to accommodate all those angels. In other words, when God comes with his angels, they're going to be, it's not just like one little cloud of angels there, as we see in the pictures. The angels will encircle the whole planet. 1, 2, 3, 4 layers deep. You know, the Bible tells us in Matthew 28 that when the angel came and rolled the stone from the tomb, the Bible says his countenance or his face looked like lightning. Yes. Angel's face looks like lightning. What will it be like when you've got 10,000 times 10,000 and 1,000,000 angels, all of them shining like lightning, but even they are dimmed by Jesus' brightness? Yes. It's going to be like, that's why the wicked run to an inanimate object like a mountain and say, please fall on me, Lord. Because God's glory is so great, which is also why the righteous, even at that moment, say, who can stand? Who can stand? Like, this is a dramatic end to the story. Like, if you were reading this book as you get to the last few chapters, you'd be like, please, I want it to end, but I don't want it to end. Because, like, surely there's something great that's going to happen in the next page. Then the voice of Jesus is heard, saying, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace has always been sufficient for you. And in this moment of earth history, my grace is still sufficient for you. And she says, the faces of the righteous are lighted up, and joy fills every heart, and the angels strike a note higher. They just take it up one more notch. Like, they were singing soprano at that point, and then they just take it to a new stratosphere that we yet have not experienced. As they come nearer and nearer to the earth. God is good, amen? God is good. Like in that moment when the righteous are like, can we stand? God's like, don't worry. My grace is sufficient for you. My grace is sufficient for you. And they come and God takes his people. Reading here, it says, amid the reeling of the earth, the flash of lightning, the roar of thunder, the voice of the Son of God calls forth the sleeping saints. He looks upon the graves of the righteous, and raising his hands, he cries, awake, awake, ye that sleep in the dust, and arise, length and breadth of the earth, the dead will hear that voice. And they will live. I've always wondered what is going to happen. What I think, like the Waldensian valleys, which I've been to, where they were pushed off the mountain. The stakes where they were burned. There's no body left. But God is not dependent upon a physical matter for a resurrection. But I just imagine where the people, are they going to be resurrected from the spot where they died? Like, I don't know. But maybe that's the case. Imagine from the Colosseum, how many people will come up from there? Where the Christians were killed for the sport of the masses. I mean, it's just rising. Imagine the people that have drowned in the sea just... And the whole earth will ring with the tread of an exceedingly great army of every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. She says, angels gather together the elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. And then she paints this picture where she says, little children are born by holy angels to their mother's arms. Like in the midst of this greatest moment of earth's history, Jesus is like, forget not the little children. Amen. And the angels pick them up and carry them and put them in the arms of their mothers. She says, friends long separated by death are united, never more to part, and with songs of gladness ascend together to the city of God. Amen. On the way to the city, we're told it's going to take 7 days to get to the city. 7 days. Like that's a whole week. Can you imagine what it's going to be like going to the city? You're there with your angel, and you start to have a discussion with your angel. Because you have an angel. What's that conversation going to be like? Like it's going to be meeting an old friend. We're not going to be speaking in King James English to our angel. They'd be like, man, you know how many times I had to save you? I'm glad you're here though. I don't know. But we're going to talk and catch up with our angel. And as we're talking and catching up with our angel, it's then that we see in the distance old brother so-and-so from church that we haven't seen for 20 years. And kind of leaning forward and putting our fist out, we fly over to him. And then we get there and we're like, hey! And he's like, hey, you made it! You made it! Praise the Lord. Can you just imagine like all the people you get to see on the way there? And maybe as we're ascending to the city, we're just kind of ascending. It's day three and we're ascending. And all of a sudden we look over there and, oh man, it's like the prophet Abraham. Whoa. Hey, angel, can you go introduce me to Abraham? He's like, sure, no problem. You go over and talk to Abraham. Now this is even before you get to heaven. Like, you haven't even got there yet. The journey there is going to be fun. Like a 7-day journey? Like you can't even imagine that if you live on Bermuda your whole life. Like how many times do you have to drive from end to end? In 7 days. You'd go crazy. Like a 7-day journey. But it'll be the sweetest journey that there ever is. You know, we'll pass galaxies, we'll pass stars, we'll go through solar systems. And the beauty that we'll behold will just take our breath away. We'll take our breath away. It's here, it says, we all entered the cloud together and were 7 days ascending to the sea of glass when Jesus brought the crowns and with his own right hand placed them on our heads. He gave us harps of gold. He gave us harps of gold and palms of victory. Here on the glass, the 144,000 stood in a perfect square. Some of them had very bright crowns. Others, not so bright. Some crowns appeared heavy with stars, while others had but a few. But all were perfectly satisfied with their crown. There was no one who had three crown or whatever stars on his crown and is looking across at the Apostle Paul and is thinking, just wait till he puts that thing down. Like everyone, she says, is satisfied with their crown, almost as if they don't even know how big or small it is. Because they know that whether it's big or small, it's only because of Jesus anyway. And she says, they were clothed with a glorious white mantle from the shoulders to the feet. Angels were all about us as we marched over the sea of glass to the gate of the city. Jesus raised his mighty, glorious arm, laid hold of the pearly gate, and swung it back on its glittering hinges. You have washed your robes in my blood. And I like the next few words. Stood stiffly for my truth. Enter in. And we all marched in and felt we had a perfect right to the city. They marched in and felt that they had a perfect right to the city. We all went under the tree. You know, she paints this scene, and I find this fascinating, so I put these quotes at the end. She says that they're in heaven, and she envisions, I can see this. And she says, we were under the tree, and we sat down to look at the glory of the place. And then she says, we saw Brother Fish and Stockman. Those are two of the pioneers. You know, what? I think it's Fish. I forget which one it is. It's one of these two, I believe, that was baptizing people in the cold New England water 11 days before the Great Disappointment. He was baptizing people 11 days before the Great Disappointment in October, New England, when the water was freezing cold, because so many people wanted to make sure they were baptized before Jesus came. And he stood there so long baptizing people in the freezing water that he caught pneumonia and died. And she says, I saw Brother Fish and Stockman in heaven. She says, they preached the kingdom of the kingdom whom God had, notice the phrase, whom God had laid in the grave to save them. They came up to us and asked us what we had passed through while they were sleeping. They're like, what happened? What happened? And she says, we tried to call up our greatest trials, but they look so small compared with the far more exceeding and eternal way of glory that surrounded us that we could not speak them out. And we cried out, hallelujah, heaven is cheap enough. Like if you weighed up, what is it that you have to give? And then you weighed up, what is it you get? They say heaven was cheap enough. Like things that seem like such a big sacrifice now. And we stand up in church and testify of such the hard thing we have to give up. Maybe in our mind's eye right now it is. At that moment, though, she's like, we'll see it in this real life and just be like, this is a good deal. Heaven was cheap enough. And we touched our glorious hearts and made heaven's arches ring. Heaven is cheap enough. See, heaven is cheap enough because Jesus paid the price for us to be there. When we say heaven is cheap enough, in the sense the quotation isn't understood in the context of what we had to give up, what we had to give up to get there. So it's cheap for us. However, You'll never hear God say salvation was cheap.
No.
We'll say heaven was cheap. God will never say your redemption was cheap. Because he knows that the only way we were saved was because he was willing to give up his only son. His only son. And say, I'll give my only son, but I can get back and save these rebellious humans. You know, I'm looking forward to going to church in heaven. And it won't be a church where we're watching our watches. I've been to many, many churches in this world. And every church I go to, I always ask, because every church is different and there's a culture in every church. And I always say, what time do you finish here? Because you want to respect people's church customs. And some churches are like, whenever you want. But you know they don't really mean it. The person telling you might mean it, but the kids don't mean that. And other churches will tell you explicitly, we're a 12:15 church. I go, okay. Another church will tell you we're a 12 o'clock church. Another church will tell you, no, we finish here at 12:30. Because the Holy Ghost leaves at 12:31. Another church will tell you that we're like a 1 o'clock-ish church. And you hear all types of stuff wherever you go. And that's fine. As a preacher, you have to work within whatever people are used to. But when we get to heaven, and we have church in heaven, it's going to be a case of, can we keep going?
Yeah.
When we stop and hear the choir, and in my mind's eye, you know who I imagine is going to be in the heavenly choir? It's going to be all the people on earth who are deaf and dumb. Like, seriously, they can't speak, they can't hear, and they will be the ones that we will stop and listen to.
That's right.
As they sing with beautiful voices.
Yeah.
And can you imagine hearing some of the testimonies in heaven? And it's like, oh, that's good, that's a good testimony. Oh, that's a powerful testimony. Oh, maybe we'll get to hear a Daniel seminar by Daniel. I don't know. And then, and then Jesus stands up. He stands up. Ellen White paints a scene where the first Adam meets the second Adam. But Jesus stands up. And he starts to give a series of sermons on the first Sabbath. And the sermon series is going to be entitled, God is Love. And it's not a sermon series that's a three-part series. It's not a sermon series that is a seven-part series. It's not a sermon series that is a 10-part series. It's not a 52-part series. But it's something we're told we're going to forever be understanding deeper and more fully the concept of God is love.
Amen.
You know, in heaven, there's nothing man-made except the scars on Jesus' hands. But this is the thing that gets me. Like, Jesus has all power. Amen? Like, he heals blind men with his saliva. He heals other people when they simply touch the hem of his garment. He heals other people by saying, oh, by the way, your son who's at home that I can't even see, he's already been healed. Jesus heals all types of people, yet why is he limited and doesn't heal his own scars? I've got scars on my head here, one here, one here, and I believe when I get to heaven, those scars will be gone. So why is it that Jesus has scars on his hand? Is he physically, spiritually unable to heal his own scars? Of course not. If he can heal a man's eyes with his saliva, he can heal his own scarf by just... Jesus keeps his scars intentionally. So that forever throughout eternity, you and I know the cost of our salvation. So that forever throughout eternity, we never forget the price that God had to pay, the price Jesus paid by giving up his life to pay for our salvation. And seeing those scars in 2 million years' time will remind us again of the grace of God. I don't know about you, but I want to be in heaven. I want to be there and I want to hear the sermon of Jesus up there in glory when he talks about love. How many of you want to be there, church? You want to be there? I want to be there. I want to see you there too. You want to see me? I want to see you too. You know, as we close this message this evening, I'm going to invite my wife, she's going to come up and sing a song again. And it reminds us of the cost of our salvation. The cost that we'll remember in heaven every time we see the scars on Jesus' hand.